Hey, Al, can you hear me? Hey, Al, can you hear me?
I'm not hearing anything from the live stream, unless we're really delayed. Ethan, can you make the screen? There we go.
Do you want me to take this off?
Al, can we do that FaceTime?
Yes, yes, thank you. I'm actually going to put you in charge because I don't ever remember doing that.
Can you FaceTime with me?
Whenever you're here and I didn't do it, please do it.
Do because I
you do. Okay, do what you do.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll take the.
I guess so.
Yeah. Okay. You'll want to turn off your camera. Yeah. You know how to do that?
Okay, I'll follow you.
And, yeah, whatever's on
put,
the...
Put this on the screen up front.
Put it into the office.
In the office.
In the office.
So Ethan.
In library. In there? Or in the library. Okay. Can I help you with that?
No.
Okay. What about...
Wow, that is so cool.
Yep. All right, we're good. It's working. So you can stop it out, and then you can go back to your room. So, yes, this will be filming. Yeah, we don't have that.
What about the pulpit? Do we take that off of there?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Well, okay. I would do that. I was gonna have everybody just concentrate on the altar.
So you'll do that.
I'll do that and do the eternal life.
Oh, okay.
What do you want me to do? Take whatever is on the,
we're just gonna do that.
On the altar.
Take
go with everybody else.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Anything that is on the altar needs to come up.
And go in the library.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
More the merrier.
Yeah, I guess there's something else.
No, nothing.
Free lunch.
That was impressive.
I
did want to put it.
I was like the one in Sunnyvale too, because it had a story behind it.
Exactly.
I was going through the reading.
That are going to be a little bit different. One of the things is we normally in the tradition of the church, there's a stripping of the altar at the end of the Monday Thursday service, and because we had the Monday Thursday service in Kurtz Hall, the stripping of the altar will happen at the beginning of the Good Friday service. Also, there will be a Stations of the Cross done at the end of the service. And I'll remind you of this a little later, but you'll congregate at the back of the sanctuary over there, kind of by the cry room, and Grant will be leading you through the stations. Everything else is in the bulletin. We're going to be hearing the story of the Passion broken down, and each verse will be separated by, each section of Scripture will be separated by one verse from a hymn. We begin our service with the prelude and the stripping of the altar. Let us pray.
Almighty God, wilt with loving mercy on your hand.
For whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Isaiah chapter 52. See, my servant shall prosper, he shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which had not been told them they shall see, and that which they had not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. We're going to be reading Psalm 22 by the sides of the sanctuary. So it'll start with the Old Testament side here, and start with the New Testament side over here, and follow with the Old Testament side. My God, my God.
They cried out. ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nation shall bow before God.
For dominion belongs to the Lord, the rulers of the nations.
Indeed, all who sleep in the earth shall bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust, though they be dead, shall kneel before the Lord.
Their descendants shall serve the Lord, whom they shall proclaim to generations to come.
They shall proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying to them, the Lord has acted.
Reading of the Passion. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he, so if you're looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of these whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple who was known to the high priest went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Anna sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again Peter denied it, and at that moment the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked again, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him. But you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Thank you.
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of the greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus. Then he handed them over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what was called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." The soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that scripture might be fulfilled. none of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look upon the one on whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one, because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to take away the body, let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. My job as a preacher to tell you that these stories that have happened 2,000 plus years ago should and can affect us directly today. But I think too often in church we are on the edge of understanding what they mean for us. We're on the edge of a precipice. Because if we make it just about this story that happened to Jesus over 2,000 years ago, like a story from history, it's easy. It's like reading a story about something in World War II. But if we're honest with ourselves on what Good Friday can and should mean for us, it's like hanging on the edge of a cliff. And what's at stake is big. Are we really going to follow the teaching of Jesus or not? Because lives are quite literally at stake. I read an essay by a pastor in North Carolina. Her name is Kate Murphy. I'm going to read that for you. Christians call the day Jesus was crucified Good Friday. It's mystifying. Why would people who claim Jesus as their Lord and Savior call the day he was brutally murdered by the state a good day? Many Christians have been told that Friday is good because on that day Jesus paid the price for our sins, that God needed someone innocent and righteous to suffer so that he could show mercy to guilty and unrighteous people like us. The takeaway has been, now that Jesus had been unjustly punished for our wrongdoing, Christians are righteous by default no matter what. It's a good day when Jesus prepays the tab on your sin. This isn't necessarily good theology. We have taken exactly the wrong lesson from Good Friday when we see Jesus hanging on the cross and think, well, sometimes innocent people have to suffer unjustly for the common good, and it's not my problem or responsibility. The death of Jesus does not justify evil, but it exposes it. The cross forces us to see that the end never justifies the means. We cannot fight violence with violence. We cannot create peace through destruction. Before we call Friday good, we have to recognize crucifixion as horrible. Then we have to see that crucifixion didn't just happen only one time and only to Jesus. They still happen all the time, even today. Crucifixion is an execution by asphyxiation. In spite of all the blood in Mel Gibson's version, crucifixion victims don't die from blood loss from nails piercing flesh. Those wounds cause unspeakable agony, but they don't kill you. Death occurs from suffocation because eventually the body loses the strength to hold up the chest cavity enough to breathe. This is why they broke the thieves' legs. Crucifixion is painful, slow, forced self-strangulation. Theologian James Cone wasn't being metaphorical when he called the cross a lynching tree. It literally was. It's a crime of stolen breath. In the seventh verse of the second chapter of Genesis, we see God shape the first human form from dust and then breathe into his nostrils. This is the breath of life. It is only after that gift that the man becomes a living being. Scripture testifies that breath is life and its sole source is God. When humans take breath and reduce a living being back into a lifeless body, it is a desecration and an act of decreation. But that's not all it is. When we conspire to remove the breath from someone's body, that's not just a crime against the victim, but also against God, because it's God's own breath that has been stolen. Christians believe Jesus is God. Seeing him struggling to breathe on the cross is supposed to finally force us to see that all violence is violence against God. To take anybody's breath is to take God's. To lynch is to crucify. To kneel on someone's neck until they suffocate is to crucify. To launch terrorist attacks against civilians, shedding the blood that carries the breath, is to crucify. To bomb a home or hospital or refugee camp so that the breath is crushed out of bodies is also to crucify. To withhold food or medical supplies from a population until breath is collectively extinguished from bodies is mass crucifixion. Friday isn't good because crucifixion is good, or because God made something good come from crucifixion. God didn't crucify Jesus. Humans did. God is not the crucifier, even indirectly. God is the crucified. Jesus' death exposes the lie that violence could ever be good, justified, or holy. Good Friday is good because it is the day that Jesus shows us that there is another way, a way of absorbing and transforming violence without perpetuating it. The tragedy is most Christians aren't interested in following Jesus on that way. Many of us still believe that only force powerful enough to end violence is greater violence. More than 2,000 years later, we still live in a world where the powerful find ways to crucify those they fear and despise. We uphold and participate in unjust and destructive systems that sanitize and sanctify brutality and exploitation, all the while claiming to provide justice and peace and prosperity. The sin isn't that we failed to transform our systems, but that we have failed even to try. We are standing on a precipice. We're living on the edge. God is calling us away from violence. That's the message of the cross. To say that there's another way other than the brutal ways of the world. But we have to choose it. And that takes courage. And it isn't easy. Amen. We will be taking an offering at this time.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. God of glory, receive these gifts and the offering of our lives. As Jesus was lifted up from earth, draw us to your heart in the midst of this world, that all creation may be brought to freedom, from darkness to light, from death to life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So I'm going to be doing a bidding prayer. What a bidding prayer is, there's going to be long sections of silence. And that is for you to reflect, meditate for a moment on what was prayed right before that. Sometimes silence in church can be a little uncomfortable. And if there's a night that that's okay, it's on Good Friday. So sit in that sort of bit of uncomfortableness. Let us pray for the Church of Jesus Christ throughout the world, for its unity and witness and service, for all ordained ministers and the people they serve, for all Christians in this community, that God will confirm the Church in faith and increase it in love and preserve it in peace. Let us pray for all people and nations of the world, and for those in authority among them, for our president and for the government of this country, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth, that all might live in peace and harmony. Let us pray for all who suffer, for the hungry and the homeless, the deprived and the oppressed, for the sick, the wounded, and the handicapped, for those in loneliness and fear, for those in confusion, in doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and all at the point of death, that God's love will comfort and sustain them, and that we may be stirred up to minister to them. Faithful and compassionate God, you created and love all the peoples of the earth. May your good news be so lived and proclaimed that all are brought home to your presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. God, our refuge and strength, accept the fervent prayers of your people and bring to fulfillment your plan for all creation through Jesus Christ, who is alive with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray the prayer that you yourself taught us. Our Father, who
art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as
So we will be doing Stations of the Cross, and that is going to be outside, and we're not coming back inside. So take your coats and things with you as you go. You're going to have a tour guide. The tour guide is Grant. He's standing at the back of the sanctuary, and he will lead you on your way. There are 14 stations, and there's a variety of experiences awaiting you on these 14 stations. God bless you this Good Friday.
I have to wait for my tour group. Well, hello, and welcome to our Stations of the Cross experience. As we begin our journey, we start with the celebration of Passover with Jesus and his disciples. If you would please step into this room with me. Okay, step into the space. We got a lot of people to fit in here, so. So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Truly, I tell you, one of you shall betray me."
And they became greatly distressed and began to say to him one after another,
"Surely not I, Lord.
Surely not I, Lord.
Surely not I,
Lord.
Surely not I,
Lord.
Surely not I, Lord.
The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man, as it goes, written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one to have not been born."
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said,
"Take.
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many of the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never drink again from this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
Let us proceed outside the walls of Jerusalem to the Garden of Gethsemane. Please follow me. We're not going very far. The Garden of Gethsemane is very cold today. You all have places you need. Yes. So we're gonna go. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to the disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved. Even to death, remain here and stay awake." "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want.
Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to them,
"So, you cannot stay awake with me 1 hour. Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done."
Again, he came and found them sleeping,
for their eyes were heavy.
So leaving them again, he went away. And he prayed for a third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is now at hand."
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived with him. And there was now a large crowd with swords and clubs. You all are the large crowd with swords and clubs.
Hey!
From the chief priests and the elders of the people, now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi."
"Friend, do what you are here to do."
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Now we continue as Jesus is brought before Pilate. Please follow me. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. And Pilate asked him,
"Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas from them instead. And Pilate spoke to them again.
"Then what do you want me to do with this man you call the King of the Jews?"
And they all responded,
Crucify him!
"Why? What evil has he done?"
And they responded, Crucify him! So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Please follow me to the crown of thorns.
Okay, good job. High five.
As the soldiers led Jesus into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him,
Hail, King of the Jews! They struck his head with a reed and spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. I invite you all to take a look at the torture that Jesus endured. If you wish, you may taste the vinegar that they gave Jesus to drink as well.
Taste the vinegar, touch the thorns, touch the whip.
As the crowds gathered, as Pilate reemerged, they all shouted, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!
Away with him! Crucify him!"
And Pilate said,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
They all responded, "We have no king but the emperor."
"We have no king but the emperor."
Then they handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. Here Jesus fell carrying the cross. Please, follow me to the next station. There's a screen, so you all need to be able to see the screen, so keep sliding down. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Please follow me to the next station. We're going to all gather right here. As you arrive at the eighth station, a passage from Luke, chapter 23, verses 27 through 31. A great number of the people followed Jesus, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming where they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry? When you have received your tear from the woman of Jerusalem, we will continue." Please follow me to our next station. On chapter 19, Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." Written in Hebrew, black.
Okay. The offering, where do you want me to put it?
"This man, and I am king of the Jews." And Pilate answered, "They took his..." They divided his clothes amongst themselves, and for Jesus' clothes they cast lots. And that is what the soldiers did. Please proceed with me to our next station. Going back this way. Yeah. Okay, this is... No one. Welcome to Station 10, The Good Thief. A reading from Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And he replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." So please follow me and observe the remembrance of the good thief. The 11th station, Mary and John below the cross. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus, where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene, when Jesus saw his mother and the disciples, whom he loved, standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciples, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciples took her into his own home.
Mom, I need to make sure you'll be all right while I'm gone, okay? I love you.
Please follow me to the 12th station, the death of Jesus.
Can I skip out on that?
Here, will you go back and hold a flashlight? Everybody gather on in here. I promise I don't bite. I just tell stories. No. Oh, I'm sorry, I took you to the wrong spot. Head back to the screen. I took you to the wrong spot. You don't have to move if you can see the screen from here. From Mark chapter 15, 33 through 39. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice. Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, listen, he is calling for Elijah. And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, and put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come and take him down. Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that it was this way, he breathed his last, and he said, truly this man was God's son. From the book of Matthew, chapter 27, verses 57 through 61. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite of the tomb. Please follow me to the 14th station. Now you're up front. Hello. From Matthew 28, verses 1 through 7. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was drawing, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who is crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised. And he said, 'Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you.'" And now if we... I guess we are closed until Sunday morning. I hope to see you all there. Thank you. Oh, yes. Congratulations. You won the casting of the lots.